So now I would like to welcome Lucy Sanders, the co-founder and CEO of NCWIT, to introduce the 2021 NCWIT Pioneer in Tech Award. Hi, Lucy. We're excited to have you on today.
Well, hi. I hope you can see me and hear me.
Yes, we can.
Oh, perfect. Well, welcome everybody to one of my favorite events of the year, the Honoring the Pioneer in Tech. I don't think I could do a better intro than what Dr. Lisa Cook just did in terms of why it's so important that we recognize the women who have come before us in terms of their technological innovations and contributions, and why? Well, because we can recognize them. They certainly deserve it. We can also learn from them. They can serve to inspire us and future generations. And so at NCWIT, we really believe in this fully, and every year we look for an honoree. And, you know, sometimes people go, well, we didn't know who that was. And it's so important that we get the message out that we have so many great innovators that need to be recognized in this way. So today we're honoring Dr. Glayds West with the 2021 Pioneer in Tech Award from NCWIT. Dr. West, I have to say, is so amazing. She earned her PhD at the age of 70 years old. And she got a master's in mathematics from Virginia State College, which is now Virginia State University. She was hired by the Navy at the Dahlgren, Virginia location in 1956, and she worked there for 42 years. At the time of her hiring, she was only the second Black woman who had ever been hired and one of only four Black employees. She is perhaps well known for her mathematical modeling for the development of satellite, and I had to look up how to say this, y'all, geodesy models that were eventually incorporated into the global positioning or GPS systems that we use so much today. So she is a technological innovator, and we're so excited to honor her with this award. I do know, though, that, you know, we hear that, you know, she's the brains behind a lot of the mathematical computation in GPS today, but she also likes maps and loves to trust her own brain in reading maps, and it made me kind of want to go pull out a map, my atlas, and go look to see if I could still read that. So we are tremendously excited. This is absolutely one of my favorite things that we do at NCWIT. So before we hear from Dr. West, I think we'd like to play a video which has sort of a short recap of her life and career.
When I grew up as a little girl, I was in a country area, rural area, and we made our living by having a farm. I told myself that I did not like being out in the sun and working from sunrise to sunset and all that. So I made good grades in all of my subjects. So it was time to go to college. Well, since you're doing well in all subjects, you can major in math. And we know that you'll be successful. So when I went to college, I majored in math. Graduated after 4 years. I had applied for jobs in the government. I got hired in Dahlgren in 1956. I came by myself. My husband wasn't with me or anything. I was by myself. I at least put it this way. I didn't know him at that time. At the same time that we were coming to work here, they were also bringing in a large computer, and they hired these mathematicians to learn to work this computer. We hadn't had any computer teaching or knowledge, so we had to master this job that they want us to do. So we had to learn how to program and code for this big computer. My part in the global positioning system would be working more with the orbit over the water. A lot goes into the scientific computation to generate an orbit, which is a database used in GPS. So the different people who did civilian applications learned to use the database that we generated, and that was the foundation that GPS was built on. When you grew up as a little black girl, our school was separated from the white schools. And we had separate buses. And many times we would get the old hand-me-down things from the white school, books that weren't new like their books were. But all of that helped to make us, I think, work harder because, you know, you were behind the eight ball to start with, you know, so you had to work harder. But I always was motivated by doing something new and completing something, having a goal. Because usually I had a mind of my own. I tend to think for myself, a little impatient with others who don't think the way I do.
Well, thank you very much. That's a great video. And I'd like to now ask Dr. West to join us on camera and make a few remarks, and after which we will have an interview, a short Q&A session.
Okay. Good afternoon. Thank you for those wonderful words that was just given. I am extremely honored to receive the Pioneer in Tech Award. I am very thankful to NCWIT for the recognition. Many years ago, I committed myself to be the best that I could be. Through my successes and challenges, I stayed focused and persevered, never losing sight of my goals. Being recognized at this point in my life brings some closure to a long and committed journey. I have recently published my memoirs entitled, It Began with the Dream. I had many thoughts and dreams that dominated my thinking throughout my developmental years. I encourage each of you to always move confidently toward your dreams yourselves. I would like to say thank you to all who have helped me along the way. I thank God for all that he has done and for continuing to oversee my life. Thank you again to NCWIT for giving me this great honor. I will always cherish it. Thank you.
It's wonderful. And we're so happy to see the award is there. So that's awesome. We are excited to have you here today to do some short Q&A. And we're not the only ones honoring you, Dr. West. I have a letter here from Eddie Bernice Johnson, who is the U.S. Congress chairwoman of the Science Committee. And I'd like to just read it here. And I believe we sent it to your daughter. So she has a copy too, in case you haven't seen it. but it's really wonderful to be honored. Chairwoman Johnson sponsored the Hidden Figures Gold Medal Act that cleared Congress, I think, about a year ago. And so I'll just read it, if I may. Modern day America was built upon the contributions of talented engineers and mathematicians such as yourself. Your service to this country is a living testimony to the trailblazing abilities in women with their eyes set on the future. It makes me sad, I'm just so excited. So great. From your foundational modeling work on the original global positioning system to your work on the CSAT remote sensing technology, your brilliance, hard work, and dedication have yielded lasting benefits to society. As chairwoman of the Committee on Science, Space, and Technology, and throughout my 28 years in Congress, I have worked to ensure a continuing federal commitment to empowering our nation's scientists so that they can do what they do best. And I thank you for your pioneering efforts. As the second African-American woman ever to be hired at the then Naval Proving Ground, you exemplified persistence, humility, and excellence that serves as a model to students, particularly women and students of color. I have no doubt that careers like yours will inspire the next generation of diverse women engineers, mathematicians, programmers, and inventors. I was thrilled to lead the effort to enact legislation to honor the hidden figures like you. You are one more example whose contributions to society have been overlooked. It is a privilege to share sisterhood with you in Alpha Kappa Alpha sorority. I cannot think of a more deserving awardee and offer my congratulations on your recognition as an NCWIT pioneer in tech. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
And now I'd like to introduce TJ Alladin from the NCWIT staff, who manages our community of students. Dr. West, we have thousands of students across the United States who will be inspired by you, and she's got some questions to ask you.
Thank you so much, Lucy, and thank you even more, Dr. West. I am TJ Alladin, as Lucy said, and I have the honor of interviewing you today. Here at my job, I get to manage 20,000 women in tech nationwide between high school and their first 2 years in the workforce. And in honor of you, I did the math by hand, and I have worked at NCWIT for 1,822 days. I promise you, I did not Google that. Thank you so much for being here, and thank you for all that you have contributed to the world. My first question for you is, how would you describe yourself to someone who has never met you before? There have been so many articles written about you by other people in Forbes and The Guardian, so on and so forth, but I would really love to know, what would you say to someone who has never heard of you before?
Yeah, I think I see myself a little bit different from others many times, because I feel so humble and dedicated and concerned about whatever I'm involved in. I just feel like it's a privilege for me to be smart enough to understand what the big fuss is all about, what the world is doing. And I believe like having a plan, working on a plan, setting goals and working those goals, and keep doing that and making sure that I'm meeting them and I'm reaching what I want to do at stages, and just continue to do that. Not so much having a whole lot of fun, but always being busy all the time, dedicated to what I'm involved in. And so sometimes I get discouraged by myself and I say, well, you should be having more fun or doing other things, but I have no desire. I just sort of stay there, working and trying to resolve what it is that I'm involved in. So I'm just so happy that other people are recognizing this and giving me these awards. This is wonderful. Thank you.
Well, I at least hope that we can have a little bit of fun today. We'll try and squeeze in some fun. My next question is based on what you just said about how you continue to work towards different projects and like initiatives. How do you find the motivation to keep going, especially as a woman in mathematics? The numbers are still quite low. How do you find the strength to continue to do the work that you do?
Yeah, I don't know. I think maybe setting the goals, and so your timeline is just that goal at the time, and you sort of reach that goal, so that's an incentive. That was my excitement point, is to reach a goal that you've been working on and seeing that you can do it and then trying something else. So you sort of incite yourself, we'll keep going. And so I don't have any problem with, not continuing, but I do have a problem with not being busy all the time. I want to be doing something, working something. So that's me.
That's awesome. I feel the same. I like to stay super busy all the time. So we both have to work on trying to squeeze in some fun. So as I mentioned before, I get to manage a very large community of people. And I have a question in honor of the 10th and 12th graders at the Cristo Rey High School in Brooklyn and their teacher, Mr. Bernard. They are curious to know what advice for them you have at this stage to keep pushing forward, because math is hard. So what advice do you have for them?
Well, we're finding out now in today's society that more information about STEM is being provided. There are more activities, more events, more people getting involved. And so that is always a source where they can join some of the groups in their community and take advantage of that. And even in schools also, some of the teachers are beginning to be very conscious of STEM. And I always sort of feel like you find yourself a person who's interested in it, and then talk to them, have them help you, help direct you to where you would like to go. You may not know exactly what your final point is or what you're finally interested in, but ask for some guidance. And you got to work. And you got to sort of spend some time digging yourself. You shouldn't sit and wait for somebody else to come show you the way and push you along. You know, you got to be curious, and you got to just talk to other people and move along. You can almost tell all the kids who are going to really excel real fast because they're so curious about life in general and testing and trying things.
Thank you so much for that response. And I think that was excellent advice for those students. And I think they're gonna cherish it forever and ever. I know I will. I wanna just cue the audience now. You can start to submit any questions that you have into the Q&A. I'm gonna continue to ask Dr. West some more questions, but in a moment we will get to your questions. So my next question for you, Dr. West, is about you getting your PhD. Okay, what? So you accomplished all of these amazing things, you retired, and then you went back and got a PhD. And you were still the only Black woman in your course. Was that surprising to you?
Yeah, I guess surprising that I was the only Black woman at that time. I would have thought there were some others. But I didn't really ever quit school. When I retired, I had all my coursework done. I had done all the basic work done for the PhD. So it looks like I started back, but I didn't start back. And I had all the experience of working with the men who were in the program along with me and learning a lot about how they were and resolving issues like who's smarter than who and all that kind of thing. I had all those experiences. And now I just and left that at the end to say, I got to settle down, I'm free, I can do it. And so I just attacked it and got the dissertation written and graduated.
That is amazing and so inspiring. I have a master's degree. I'm pursuing another master's degree. And now that I know, I have another 40 or 50 years if I want to get my PhD, because you have charted that path for me now, so I can see something different. Yeah, so thank you for that. I want to ask about something you mentioned before, which is about staying humble. So I don't know, but if somebody wrote about me in Forbes, I don't know if I could stay too humble. So you are being talked about worldwide now. You're being recognized for work that you've done. Has that changed you at all?
It changed me in the sense that in my heart, I feel a lot of what people are expressing. I feel that. But outwardly, I still feel like I need to step softly and look and make sure where I'm going, because I don't feel like I did it. You know, I feel like I had some blessings. I have a feeling that somebody else was steering the ship and I was just on the ship. And because there's so many people who have helped me that I never thought that they were helping me and made it possible. Even I had a lady who took care of the house while I was with my head down in the books and stuff, you know. But that was very important because it gave me comfort and security that things were all right at home. So I'm thankful. I'm as excited as those people are talking outward, but inwardly, I'm still humble about what I have done. I'm just feeling blessed.
Yes. Yeah, I am feeling blessed to have this opportunity to chat with you. I really love that you mentioned all of the people around you that helped to support you on your journey. Who would you say was the most impactful person for you as you were pursuing your goals?
I would say that probably my mother was the most impactful, I would think. But then as I look back along the way, there were a lot of others also because I didn't have a lot of money, so I had to get a job. So I worked at the home of a math professor and a physics professor. And so even though that they didn't always just labor and talk to me exactly about what to do and all, but they were really role models, and I was eyeing them, what they were doing, and I was sort of following their guide as the way I should be going. How should I carry myself? What should I do? How hard should I work? And I was getting all of this, so they had a big impact on me also. And I tried to pick friends also that were a positive influence also. So I guess I've been surrounded by some wonderful people that I didn't know. I thought I was doing everything, but I was just sort of copying a whole lot of what was around me.
That's really great to hear that you had so many different people supporting you along your journey, including men. I think that's excellent. We don't hear enough, I think, about the people that get it right, and that this is a problem that all genders need to come together and solve. So thank you for sharing that. Mm-hmm. I have a question for you from the audience, which is, you have set and met countless goals in your life. What do you feel most proud of looking back now?
Well, I think what I feel most proud of is just reaching the top. I just accomplished everything that I had planned to do and got to the end and was feeling like, oh boy, I still feel like I ought to be working. So then I started on something else. And so even though I worked hard and I did a lot of things, I still feel like as long as I have energy and can work, that I should be helping the world. My goal is getting bigger and bigger, I guess. I should help the world in general to arise and be counted also. So I started getting interested in the young people and telling them my story. And just having fun now at my age and my energy.
I was actually going to ask about how you get, what do you eat in the morning that you can accomplish all of these things?
Well, and not that we eat anything so particular, it's that we eat, I think. We always ate healthy breakfasts and lunches and all. Partly because I was on the farm, that's where I got started. So we're eating now well-balanced meals three times a day, and that helps. But I think it's more the inner workings of you, how dedicated, how serious you are, how do you feel about the world and your role in it, and understanding what's happening in the world and how much we need each other, to get further along and to make the world a better place to live in and all. And so if you really see how big that problem is, you gladly want to do your part. Let me do my part to hold up this end. And I do feel like I need to work for myself, be independent, stand up and be counted. And I do that all the time.
Amazing, thank you so much. I have another question from the audience, and it's a bit of a long question, so bear with me. The Atlantic recently published an article that referenced the idea that women should follow the norms of male-dominated industries in order to be successful. So essentially, women should do what the men do in certain careers in order to achieve success. What advice can you offer to Black and Brown women in these kinds of white male-dominated spaces who are trying to be successful without necessarily conforming to that particular culture?
Yeah, that's a tough one. I don't agree with a whole lot of it, but we do know that we all are different. We all are individuals. We're separate. We have our own minds. And somebody on our level don't guide us and carry us where we need to go. We are independent and work according to our own thinking and doing. So I think anybody can do any work who is interested and really want to put the time and effort and get it right and share and connect with others and let them know what you're doing and how you're doing it and be a role model for people who don't believe in women. You know, women don't have to stand back and cry. Some are really born with a lot of strength and courage, and they are fighting from the beginning. And we all are different, very different. And I just not completely clear and understand their thinking. But anyway, I think we can do it.
I agree with you 100%. And it's really great to hear that you don't agree with that line of thinking that women should change themselves. I think that alone will be very encouraging to the women listening to you right now. I have another question, which is about the support that you can get from groups. So as I mentioned before, I have the privilege of managing a group of 20,000 women in tech. And I know that you are a member of the AKA sorority. Mm-hmm. I know it's a bit different, but I'm just curious to know what it was like for you to be a member of that group. What supports did you get? And do you recommend that in order to get support from peers that women find a group of people?
Well, I don't know that absolutely necessary, but during the time that I was connected with AKA Roy, we just didn't have a whole lot of shoulders to stand on. And this lady I lived with, who was a math professor, and a friend, they would always be talking about the big meetings they had to go to and what they had to do and who they saw there and who was there. Well, anyway, but in my head, I was getting pictures of these educated women, and we didn't have that many women to like look at and stand up and be role models, you know. So hearing them talk about this group of women, and then when the lady recommended that I join EKA at the time, and I did many years ago. But when I went to my first big conference, the Boule, I saw all of these Black women, and just 10,000 maybe Black women. And that was really impressive to me. Because we hadn't seen many. And they were everything that I had imagined in my mind that a professional Black woman would look like and act like. So for me, it was a role model. It would help me because I tried to emulate, you know, some of what I was seeing. And so this other AKA always was sort of business, like, you know, work hard, did it right, no playing around. So I tend to get that same kind of modeling for myself. And so I don't think you have to be in a group that big, but I do think you have to have something that's complementary to your way of thinking, you know.
Thank you so much. That's excellent, excellent advice. And yes, the 20,000 women in our group are gonna take that on for sure. I have a few more questions for you, and then I have some special folks that I want you to meet. So I have a little surprise coming later, but I want to know, specifically because you're from a rural area, mm-hmm. and as you mentioned, the farm was the thing, it was the place to be, but you did not want to be there. Even nowadays, we find that a lot of the focus on recruiting young folks in STEM happens in the big cities and on the coasts. So I'm wondering if you have any advice for folks who are looking for more talent. How can we reach more students in rural areas?
I think it's easier now. I guess what we were doing would be sending out women on the job, we're sending out recruiters from the job, looking for the kind of people that we needed, and also for the kind of people that you could work with, and that, you know, because it's more than just the technical. And again, we have to attend some of the sessions where people are having activities that talk about their schools and what they're doing, what kind of work they do. You have to sort of tap in a little bit to the university also, and sort of be aware of all of the things that you are looking for in a person on the job. And that is sometimes it's not easy to see that far before job to after job. But you can tell the people who want to be a value, want to add to what you have, listen to. And you have to have people who can tap into that inner part also, in addition to the technical points that you want to get covered.
I think that's just so amazing to hear from you, because we often focus only on the technical skills. Can this person code? Can they do math? And I think that you're right that we sometimes miss out on the other skills that actually are going to help that person to do the, you know, do the job, to, you know, persevere. Yeah. So yeah. Thank you for that. Okay, one more question, and then some special guests will be here. I want to know from you, what changes have you seen in the past decade or so that are inspiring to you?
Well, there's been a lot of changes, I guess, and they're made pretty fast. It's hard to keep up with them. I guess at a very early time when I was younger, I didn't even know anything about STEM. So now we have more STEM activities that are popping up. And from what I'm gathering, they're being really advantageous to a lot of the young people and to the girls, and how they are stepping up and taking a part in what's available for them. And the more youth are getting involved in this, in schools, and also in, we have a little museum close by, and in this little museum where there are people who have children in high school and all who are interested in these kind of activities to put their children in. So they join the museum and they come to a lot of these activities and projects and robot training and all kinds of things. There is just more people trying to get their people into this to learn more about STEM. And I think that it's working. So we are inspiring them.
I am living proof that that is working. Growing up, I wanted to be a dancer. I still kind of want to be a dancer. I decided to pursue a career in science. And that is largely due to women like you and the work that you still continue to do. So thank you again so much. And now I want to invite Claudia and Crystal to come on camera. Claudia and Crystal are two of our Change Leader Scholars. These are women in college who are pursuing technology and who want to come and tell you a bit about themselves and to congratulate you. So Claudia and Crystal, please join us.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Hi, Dr. West. I'm absolutely honored to be here and to be congratulating you for this award. My name is Claudia Hernandez, and I'm majoring in computer science and plan to pursue special interests in artificial intelligence, machine learning, astronomy, and business. And I want to say hearing about your story is absolutely astonishing. You've been a huge inspiration to me and to my efforts. The emphasis that you put on educating girls in STEM has been a real inspiration to my efforts in trying to not only make an impactful contribution to STEM itself, but also to open the door to bring other women into STEM. So as a female majoring in computer science, I think that it's incredibly important to share stories like yours. Mm-hmm. I started a community coding club and a national resource website to help educate women and to bring them into the field and inspire them. And sharing stories with changemakers like you has been incredibly, incredibly impactful into their interest and their belief that they can, in fact, pursue and succeed in STEM. I mean, being a groundbreaking programmer and mathematician whose models and algorithms were crucial to advancing both our understanding of the world and creating GPS systems that billions use every day, all in the face of adversity, your excellence motivates me to pursue my technological aspirations fearlessly and work harder to make a difference. And I'm sure millions of other girls can say the same.
Thank you so much. Oh, that's fantastic. Now that is a winner.
It's definitely an honor to meet you. And I just wanted to say that I thank you for your relentless determination, your love of learning, your incredible journey, and ultimately your revolutionary innovations and how you've helped pave the way for women in STEM, especially women of color, to thrive in the field. You're an inspiration to me and women everywhere, and I'm honored to offer you this award that is long overdue. You're truly a pioneer for women in tech, and I'd like to congratulate and thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. This is wonderful.
And now Crystal will share some words as well.
Thank you so much for this opportunity today. Congratulations on the Pioneer in Tech Award from NCWIT, Dr. Glayds West. Your own work has impacted so much of our technology today and is a guiding light on what it means to do work ethically and on persisting regardless of being the first. So today, the percentage of Black mathematicians and computer scientists is still exceedingly low, and students from traditionally underrepresented groups who wish to excel in these fields often find themselves isolated and wondering if there is a place for them in this field. And role models like yourself are critical in making sure that talented students from traditionally underrepresented groups know that they can succeed. My own grad school journey started because a NASA mathematician who works in satellite remote sensing using GPS for climate science encouraged me to attend grad school. And my research focuses on applied cryptography, fairness, and machine learning, because I believe that regardless of which neighborhood you grew up in, you have a right to protect your data, and that data should be used fairly and ethically. Your story of resilience, hard work, and excellence has motivated me throughout my own studies and in reimagining the ways that we could chart our own paths, leave our own legacy, and in remembering that there is a place for us. I'm personally inspired by the fact that you still use paper maps over GPS and trust your intellect, because it shows a continued empathy towards accessibility and in understanding socio-technical and inclusive ways of thinking about technology and how the systems we make can impact the world. Mm-hmm. We as change leaders are all inspired by your purpose-driven life.
Thank you so much. I mean, that's beyond words. I just wish you luck in everything you're doing, both of you. That's wonderful. Make me feel, now I feel really honored that somebody is making decisions because of me.
Thank you. I have one more for you. This Zoom space is about to get a lot more impressive and a lot smarter because Dr. Cook is about to join us again. Please come on camera, Dr. Cook.
Thank you so much. And Dr. West, I want to congratulate you. I want to just tell you what an inspiration you are. And I've been stalking you for about 20 years. I just want to let you know. and I'll tell you why. My aunt was the chair of the math department at Virginia State for about 20 years. She just passed away 2 years ago, and your paths are so incredibly similar. While she grew up in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, I grew up in Milledgeville, Georgia. Our sensibilities were those country sensibilities that you're talking about, where the values of the farm, the hard work of the farm were brought to us, and at the same time, the values related to STEM. All of my mom's family is steeped in STEM. So everybody's a mathematician, an engineer, math professor. So it never occurred to me, that this was a skill that women were not supposed to have.
Yeah.
It was amazing. And when you talk about it just like she did, right? You know, I got the best grades. So they told me to go do math. Right. That's exactly what happened. And, you know, when she was teaching there, she just ran across so many people that she inspired in the way that you inspire people. And, you know, you, I'm sure, inspire many more people. Your technology has been deployed in so many different ways. And I'll tell you what, before I knew that you were such a pioneer in GPS technology, I used to ask my students when I am teaching them economics and the economics of innovation, what innovations have been life-changing that you depend on the most? And they will say, and this is, okay, so I started teaching systematically in 2005. GPS is at the top of that list.
Oh, really?
GPS is at the top of that list. Now, you know, I primarily teach men, right? So this is a good thing. This is a public service. So that they can get where they're supposed to go, and they're not circling the block, and they're not circling the earth in a long way. So we appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you so much for those kind compliments. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Cook. And thank you once more, Dr. West. Thank you as well to Claudia and Crystal for being here to also let you know how valued you are in the lives of women and all people today. I told you before that I did the math by hand and I worked at NCWIT for 1,822 days. And this is by far the best day of them all. I get the chance to honor you for all of your contributions and all the things that you're going to continue to contribute for many, many more years to come. Once again, congratulations and thank you so much, Dr. West.
Thank you so much for giving me this great honor. You know, I'm sure I'll begin to feel more and more honored to know that people are making changes to their life because of me. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And now I'm going to invite Lucy Sanders, our CEO and founder, back on camera.
Well, thank you. Now I think you know why this is our most favorite part of the NCWIT Summit by far. You know, congratulations. I'm so wrapped up in your story and everything and the students and what they're talking about, and heartfelt congratulations, because we know you're not done yet. So make sure you stay in touch and let us know what you're up to. And we are just so thrilled to honor you with this award. I just don't want this to end, this whole conversation. It was so rich and so authentic. Yeah. And I just want to encourage people who are listening, this is a great recording to share out and to inspire others and to tell your story, Dr. West, to the thousands of people we interact with every year. Yeah. So do not doubt for a moment that you will not continue, you will continue to inspire people, right?
Thank you. Yeah.
It's awesome. So thank you so much.
Yeah, for that's what I want to do, continue to inspire.
Yeah, don't worry, it's coming for sure. And thanks for joining us. I just have a few last minute housekeeping things to do before we close the summit out. And so I'm gonna ask Brittany to share her screen quickly and we'll take care of business here. Just another shout out to all of our sponsors who have made the summit possible. So thank you for your ongoing support.